And one thing which sets Jesus apart from every other religious leader in history is that all of his teaching centered on himself. His teaching was totally self-centered. There are other religious leaders who said, I will show you the way. What did Jesus say? I am the way. Others have said, I'll switch on the light. Jesus said, I am the light. His invitation was this, come to me.
When Jesus became a man, he became a real human being with all of life's battles and pain. The Jesus You Never Noticed, an 8-part series from Charles Price, shows how Christ's life reflects our own struggles. Discover the real Jesus, the Jesus You Never Noticed. Today's message is called The Uniqueness of Christ. Listen to him.
Let me read to you from the Gospel of Luke and chapter 9. And for a number of weeks, we've been looking at some key events in the life of Jesus. I've called it the Jesus You Never Noticed. And I want to look at a particular event this morning, which we often call the Transfiguration of Christ. That is a word used in Matthew's account. It's not used in Luke's account. And I want to talk to you about the significance of this. And it begins in Luke chapter 9 and verse 28. About 8 days after Jesus said this, and that eight-day period he's looking back to is when Jesus met his disciples in Caesarea Philippi. He said to them, "Who do people say that I am?" And they gave him various answers. "Who do you say?" And Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." That is significant. That is a conversation that has taken place around a week before. And now it says, 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up onto a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my Son whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at that time what they had seen. You know, there's a popular parable that has been around for a couple of centuries now, and it goes like this. A few people are blindfolded, and they're taken blindfolded to an elephant, and they're asked to describe what it is just by touching it. And one feels the leg and says, "I think this is a tree." One feels the trunk and says, "I think this is a snake." One feels the tail and says, "It's a rope." Another one feels the backside of the elephant and says, "I think it's a wall." Another one gets another leg and feels around it and says, "I think it's a pillar." And then they remove the blindfolds and they all discover that it is an elephant. Now, the point of this parable is that religious beliefs are a little bit like this. One believes one thing, another believes another thing. No one knows the whole story. Nobody knows the big picture. And so all religious ideas are valid if you believe it sincerely and genuinely, but none of them are the truth. Nobody has got hold of the whole truth. Now, that's the idea that lies behind that parable, and it's in keeping with perspectives on doctrine. The problem with that story is that the leg of the elephant is not a tree, even though one of them believes it is. The trunk is not a snake. The tail is not a rope. The backside is not a wall. The other leg is not a pillar. It actually is an elephant. There actually is something that is truthful and real that they've been touching and feeling and trying to find their way around. But this just gives expression to this very woolly kind of thinking that does exist and does exist in our culture at large, that, you know, as long as you believe something with sincerity and you are genuine about it, then it's true for you, even though it may be total nonsense that you're believing. As long as you believe it, you know, and it does you some good, that is true for you. A while ago, there was a Presbyterian theologian whose name is John Hick, and he died last year, but he was an advocate of religious pluralism. That is lots of different ideas, and we've got to find our way to accommodate all of them. And one of the things he was well known for was calling for what he called a Copernican revolution in our theology. Now, Copernicus was an astronomer in the 16th century, and he was the first to make the discovery that the solar system does not revolve around the Earth, where the Earth is the fixed point, but rather it revolves around the sun, and the sun is the fixed point. Now, John Hick's idea in this Copernican revolution is that the problem with Christianity is that it revolves around Christ. The problem with Islam is it revolves around Muhammad. The problem with Judaism is it revolves around Abraham and Moses and some of those great teachers in their history. And Hick says this is a mistake. What we need to do is revolve around God. God is the sun in the solar system, and the planets that revolve around God are Christ in Christianity, Muhammad in Islam, Abraham and Moses in Judaism. And we must get this central focus back on God and see these other aspects as minor players. Now, that was his appeal, to bring about a sort of generalized, pluralistic God awareness that didn't make too much of these minor players as he saw them. When it comes to Christianity, that is a total impossibility if you take the teaching of Jesus and the teaching of the whole of Scripture seriously. Because the claim of Christianity is that it is not just a good idea, but that it is true. And that because it is truth that we're dealing with, it is by definition exclusive and cannot be married to other ideas which are inconsistent with it, as though it was one of many truths, if that itself was not an oxymoron. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now that is deemed to be an arrogant and intolerant statement, and therefore offensive. If Jesus had said, I am a way and a truth and a life, and some of you may come to the Father through me, that would be much more acceptable. Because it offers a way through Christ, but it's not exclusive, and there may be other ways that other people may find as well. But we are not allowed to say that and still take the Bible seriously. Peter, in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, was speaking to the elders and rulers in Jerusalem. And of course, Jesus was hugely controversial, had been crucified by popular demand a few weeks before. And this is Peter standing up before the people who had brought about the crucifixion of Christ and who could well bring about Peter's demise as well. And he says to them this, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. That was a dogmatic statement, which, if it is true, eliminates any alternative means by which we may feel that we can get through to God and experience salvation. And the authorities to whom Peter was speaking were offended by this. And it says in verse 18, they commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. In the name of God, yes, you can go and speak in the name of God. But in the name of Jesus, no, that is not acceptable. Now, why do we make so much of Jesus Christ? Why don't we accept John Hick's notion that God is the common ground for all of us, and there are those who dialogue between the monotheistic religions, that is those who believe in one God, such as Islam, Judaism, Christianity, and so on, and they feel, well, maybe there's a common ground here, and John Hick was one of the architects of that kind of dialogue. But why do we say that Jesus Christ stands unique and in his position, exclusive of any equal or competitor? Well, that brings us to the passage I read just now in Luke chapter 9. Because here we have an event that we call the transfiguration of Jesus that is very important in this discussion and debate. Jesus was with Peter, James, and John. They're gone up a mountain together. And in verse 29, it says, as he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. And two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. Now, this is a remarkable event, unlike anything else in the life of Jesus, this transformation, transfiguration was something that we never see at any other time. And then the appearance of two men who had long left this earth, one 1,500 years before, one 800 years before, Moses and Elijah, appearing there with him. Context and timing of this is important. A week before, Jesus had met with his disciples. Who do people say that I am? And they gave him some of the rumors that are circulating. Some say you're Jeremiah, some say you're Elijah, some say you're John the Baptist, who's had his head chopped off by Herod a little while before. You're John with your head back on. Others say you're one of the prophets. And Jesus said, but what about you? That's an important question. Not what do people say. What about you? What are your own convictions? And Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, as Matthew records it. In Luke's record, he simply says, the Christ of God. That word Christ means the anointed one, the one who people are looking forward to as the deliverer of Israel. But now, he takes them further than simply that. And here on the mountain as he prays, this transfiguration taking place, his face like a flash of lightning, his clothes a dazzling white, and then Moses and Elijah, two of the leading personalities of the Old Testament, standing with him. Why these two men? We might wonder, why not Abraham and David, for an example? Because when Matthew began his gospel, he said, this is the record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David. So he puts Jesus right in line with David and Abraham, and those were significant men. So these two men standing with Jesus are bearing witness from history that the law and the prophets do not stand alone. They only find their fulfillment in Christ. Now, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17, when he addressed in his Sermon on the Mount, the people there on another hillside, do not think I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. The law, Moses, the prophets, Elijah, I have come to be the fulfillment of everything they said, everything they wrote, and everything they taught. So that's why Moses and Elijah, I suggest you, are standing there with Jesus. Now let's turn our attention for a moment to Peter, James, and John. We'll come back to Moses and Elijah in a moment. Peter, James, and John were three of the 12 disciples, and they often accompanied Jesus alone as a kind of inner circle. And they came with him up onto the hillside where he was praying, and they fell asleep, because in verse 32, Peter and his companions were very sleepy. They seemed to fall asleep often because these three men went with Jesus into Gethsemane, sat down and just fell asleep. So they seemed to have a bit of a problem with that. They were utterly bored so far. That's obvious. I mean, Jesus was praying. And, you know, that's a good time to shut your eyes and once in a while grunt the occasional amen. If you can manage to do that, but your mind is all over the place. And after a while, your mind begins to just calm down. And eventually you're snoring. And they were doing that. And then they suddenly woke up. And when they woke up, it says they saw his glory. They were staggered by what they saw. Peter and his companions were very sleepy. When they became fully awake, they saw his glory and two men standing with them. This is something nobody else has ever experienced before. They are staggered by it. And in verse 33, the next verse says, as the men were leaving Jesus, it mentions they were talking to him about his departure from Jerusalem, which he was to accomplish later. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to them, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. I like Luke's kind comment in brackets. Luke writes, he did not know what he was saying. Whenever Peter didn't know what was going on, he usually talked. We read more often of Peter than all the other disciples put together, things like, then spake Peter, up spake Peter. Peter lifted up his voice and said, then answered Peter. We read, then answered Peter on two occasions when Peter hadn't been asked anything. He was always talking. So he staggered by what he sees. He says this silly thing. He didn't know what he was saying. He says, Luke, he said, let's build three shelters, three tabernacles. Let's build a memorial to these three men. Let's have a Moses booth, and then we'll have an Elijah booth, and then we can have a Jesus booth. Let's put them all on the same level. Now, you see, they knew Moses and Elijah were great heroes of the past. It's easy to accept the great heroes of the past. It's easy to say Abraham Lincoln was a great president, John McDonald was a great prime minister, because they're all dead and gone, and it doesn't matter. We just say good things about them. You don't say that about people still alive. But they're going to be really generous and say, and we'll make one for Jesus. We'll put the three of them on the same level. We'll give the three of them the same dignity and put them in the same category. It's what we would call today a pluralistic approach. Let's have Moses, Elijah, and Jesus, each on a pedestal, each in a booth, side by side, together. And while Peter was saying this, even though he didn't know what he was saying, next verse says, while he was speaking, goodness knows what he would have said next if there hadn't been this interruption, but then God intervened. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them, like a heavy fog came over them all. And they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came from the cloud saying, this is my son whom I have chosen. Listen to him. And when the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. Moses had been beamed up to whatever happened to him. Elijah had just gone. And they're left only with Jesus. This is telling us something absolutely important. Moses, the law, points to Christ. Elijah, representing the prophets, all point to Christ. Now, at this moment, when the Father affirms the Son by this physical transfiguration that takes place, and Moses and Elijah are standing with him, and the disciples waking up from their nap and seeing this and getting all excited, and Peter saying, let's build three shelters, at that moment a cloud came. They couldn't see what's going on. And the Father spoke, this is my Son. This is who I've chosen. Listen to him. And Moses and Elijah are no longer there. Moses and Elijah point to Jesus. But this is the Son. Listen to him. You see, going back to the discussion a week before, who do the crowd said, I am? And they gave him the answer, who do you say? And Peter said, you're the Christ of God. That was good. He is the anointed of God. But he is more than simply that. He is equal with God in deity, in substance. And this event stands out as a pinnacle through the gospel records of the Father's affirmation that Jesus Christ is divine, is himself deity, that is, equal with the Father and equal with the Holy Spirit in substance and deity. Of course, there are other claims made about Jesus. Judaism will claim today that Jesus of Nazareth was an ordinary Jewish man. He was a preacher and an effective teacher who spoke many wise things, but his legacy was messed up by his followers who, after he had gone, elevated him and claimed that he was divine. And the Jews, or Judaism, should I say, will have no truck with the idea of his deity. Islam recognizes Christ as a true prophet sent by God. But 600 years later, he was superseded by Muhammad and his teaching. But he's still a prophet in the sequence. But that's all he is. Hinduism will recognize that Christ is an incarnation of God, akin to Krishna and other wise men within Hinduism, within Christian cults. Mormons agree that Jesus is the Son of God, but not equal with God. That is a separate thing. That he was begotten, that he had a beginning, that he had a birth, not that he was eternally with the Father in eternity past. Jehovah's Witnesses say that he is God's first creation, that he is a God, in fact, an angelic being, but he is not the God. Now, some people will say to you, well, Jesus never claimed to be God. He never made statements, I am God. And therefore, we must not go that far. And if you've talked with representatives of these various cults, when they come to your door, you meet them on a train or whatever it might be, you've probably had that kind of conversation before. But Jesus did say many things that must lead us to the conclusion that he is claiming to be God. Let me give you a couple of things in John chapter 8. I think John chapter 8 is a good chapter for this. When Jesus was having conversation with some of the Jews, and I just want you to see some almost casual things that he seemed to say. When you think about the implication of them, you realize this is very important. He said in verse 23, "You are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world." Now let me try and bring that down to our own level. Just supposing I met you for the first time, we'd never met before, and I met you outside, and I said to you, hello, what's your name? You tell me, I say, where are you from? And you say, I'm from Toronto. You're from Toronto, yeah. Where is that? Well, that's here, you know, Ontario, Canada. Oh, I see. You were born here? Yeah. Oh, okay. So you're from down here, are you? What do you mean you're from down here? Well, you know, you're from the earth, are you? Of course I'm from the earth. Where are you from? Well, I'm not from down here. I'm from above. You are of this world, but I am not of this world. No, I don't come from down here. What do you think of me? You say, wow, this is a very smart gentleman I'm talking to here. No, you would say, this guy is a nutcase. What are you talking about? You're not from down here, you're from above. What are you talking about? Well, let me give you something else Jesus said. Just down the page in verse 42. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God, and now I am here. I've not come on my own, but he sent me. So supposing I said to you, okay, did you discuss your life before you were born? You'd say to me, what? Well, did you have a discussion before you were born about what kind of life you're going to live and where you're going to live? Well, of course not. Who would I have that discussion with? Well, with your father? Did you not discuss with your father where you're going to be born? Of course I didn't. How can you discuss with your father where you're going to be born? Oh, I see. Well, I did, actually. I'm not here on my own. My father sent me. We had some discussion about this before I was born. And he told me that this is where I was to come. What would you think of me if I said that to you? What about verse 51? John 8, 51. I tell you the truth. If anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. So he said, supposing I said to you, are you a bit frightened of death sometimes? You say, well, yeah, sometimes I am. Well, look, let me make you a promise. If you do what I tell you to do, you will never die. If you fall off a building, don't worry. If you see a big truck coming for you, relax. If you do, I tell you, you'll never die. What would you think of me? And the fourth one is in verse 58 of John 8, where Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Jesus answered, before Abraham was born, I am. Which is bad English grammar, but it's a very significant statement. Abraham was the father of their race, going back more than 2,000 years. Before Abraham was born, I am, present tense. So if I said to you, you ever heard of Christopher Columbus? And you say, yeah, sure. What do you know about him? Well, in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Well, let me tell you something. Before 1492, when Columbus sailed the ocean blue, I was already here. Would you go home and say, you know, I met a really interesting man today. No, you go home and say, I met a nutcase today. I met somebody who's crazy. In fact, you might say to me, would you perhaps go down to the local psychiatric hospital and see if they got a spare bed? You might need somewhere to stay. Do you know what you would think of me might be what you would have thought of Jesus if you were one of the first century people who met him. We need to be a little bit sympathetic with the difficulty it was for some of them to get their minds around what they were hearing. But the point I'm making to you now is that the kind of things Jesus said, either he is who he claimed to be, and who he claimed to be is explicable only by the fact that he is divine, or he's a lunatic. The biggest myth, of course, about Jesus is that he was just a good teacher. Good teachers never speak the way that Jesus spoke. And one thing which sets Jesus apart from every other religious leader in history is that all of his teaching centered on himself. His teaching was totally self-centered. That was not true for any other religious leader. For instance, let me explain. There are other religious leaders who said, I will show you the way. What did Jesus say? I am the way. Others have said, I will teach you the truth. What did Jesus say? I am the truth. Others have said, I will give you the life. What did Jesus say? I am the life. Others said, I will open the door. Jesus said, I am the door. Others said, I will feed you the bread of life. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Others said, I'll give you shepherds. He said, I am the good shepherd. Others have said, I'll switch on the light. Jesus said, I am the light. His invitation was this: come to me. Then abide in me. In other words, for what Jesus taught to work and to make sense, you've got to have a living Jesus himself to make it work. The point we cannot get away with when we examine the teaching of Jesus, that Jesus could not give his teaching and then take off and leave, and the teaching still work. Which is why he said to his disciples, it's good for you that I'm going. Because when I go, then the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, will come. You see, at the moment I live in one body, and that's not good for you. Because the day is going to come when I will come back in the form of the Holy Spirit and live in the lives of every man, woman, boy, and girl who has received me. And then alone will what I've said work. It takes the living God himself living within us. And the revelation that is given to us here in these verses is that Jesus stands as the center of everything that God has revealed to us in his word, the law, the prophets, and now Christ himself. And the challenge he gives to Peter and the others is listen to him. Listen to him. Doesn't mean don't listen to Moses, but don't interpret Moses in any way which is separate from what is true of Jesus. Don't interpret the prophets in any way which separates them from Jesus. This is where the truth is embodied. And he is affirmed as his son, the Son of God, but as the Son, he is given equality with God. Because in Hebrews 1, verse 3, the writer says there, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. You want to know what the Father is like? Look at the Son. He is the exact representation of his being. And in Hebrews 1, verse 8, the Father speaks about the Son. And he says about the Son, he says, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. There you have the Father calling the Son God and saying to the Son, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. And the voice that came from within this cloud, which is the voice we recognize because this voice spoke at the beginning of Jesus' ministry at his baptism, saying, this is my Son, with him I am well pleased. This same voice comes again. This is my Son whom I have chosen. Listen to him. And the word left ringing in their ears is listen to him. Moses has spoken, and you need to know what Moses has said. But as you read what Moses has said, listen to him, Christ. When you read what the prophets, what Elijah has said, and the other prophets have said, it points to Christ. Listen to him. That's why whenever we read the scriptures and study them, our object is always to see in them Christ and to meet in them Christ. That's why Jesus said in John 5:39, criticizing the Jews, you diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. You think the scriptures themselves will give you life, but they bear witness to me and you refuse to come to me to have life. So you study the scriptures as an end in themselves rather than as a means of knowing me. And that's why they became Pharisees. You know, when I first became a Christian, I was told that I should read my Bible, and that was very good advice, but nobody told me why I should read my Bible, so I assumed that the purpose in reading my Bible was to get to know the Bible, to know the stories, get the information together. And then I wondered why it was quite hard work. But then I discovered that the purpose of reading the Bible was not to get to know the Bible, but to get to know Christ. In the words of an old hymn, beyond the sacred page, I seek thee, Lord. And if you don't know Christ, or you're not looking for Christ, the scriptures become dull, and there's a very, very good possibility you will not be reading them. Because you've got better things to do. They're designed to lead us to Christ. Let me give you an illustration of that. Hillary and I have been married for 33 years almost, and back in the early days, I was traveling a lot, as I have most all of our married life, really. And back in those early days, we didn't have emails and electronic means of communication other than a telephone. And what we now call snail mail was advertised as being fast and reliable and speedy, and you can get a letter in 5 or 6 days, and that was as fast as it used to work. And when I was traveling, I'd be away sometimes for weeks on end, a number of weeks, and we would write to each other. And sometimes I might be in a place and maybe staying in somebody's home, and mail arrives in the morning, and there's about 4 or 6 letters for me, and I notice one of them is from Hillary, so I would quickly look at the others, and then maybe get a cup of coffee and sit down and read Hillary's letter. And then, before I go to bed at night, I'd read it again. And I get up the next morning, maybe read it again. Eventually, bring it home with me when I come home. Supposing I was staying in your home, and these letters arrived, including one from Hillary, and I read it quickly, and I said to you, look, this is a letter from Hillary. It's great. Would you like to read it? You'd probably say to me, well, slightly embarrassed. You think, well, I ought to be polite, so okay, I'll read it. So you take it from me, and you read how it's been raining, because it's always raining in England, and the cat got run over by the bus, and when the kids fell off the roof, and the washing blew away in the gale, and you hand it back and say, sorry about the cat, and about the kid, hope they'll mend quickly, and hope she got the washing back. Supposing that night, I'm just about to go off to my bed, and I say, oh, when I go to bed, I'm going to read Hillary's letter. Would you like to read it first? You probably say, no, I read it this morning. I remember it. Remember I said, I'm sorry about the cat? So next morning, I meet you for breakfast, and I say, I've just been reading Hillary's letter again. Would you like to read it again? You probably say to me, listen, I am sick of Hillary's letter. I remember everything that was in it from the first time. Is that okay? Well, I remember everything in it too. So why do I read it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times and bring it home with me? And still have some of them. Is it because I'm taken up with her literary skill? No, I can't even read her writing sometimes. It's because it brings me close to her. It's because it exposes to me her heart. Because I know things that I read in what she has said that nobody else would ever know just by reading those same words. Because I know her. I know her heart. And I read it to come close. See, we're not reading the Bible for information. Somebody wrote to me not long ago and said, you suggested I read the Bible through in a year, and I'm getting towards the end of the year, and I've really enjoyed it. Could you recommend another book for next year? I say, well, go back and start again. And at the end of next year, start again. And then next year, start again. And do it every year. If you can manage to read it through a year, that's great. That's a big chunk of reading every day. But read it that through the written word, we know the living word. And Jesus said, you study the scriptures. You think in them you have life. But you refuse to come to me. And so it becomes just a legal textbook and nothing more. It doesn't bring you into my heart where you know me and we enjoy intimacy and a relationship together. And so when Peter makes this bizarre statement, let's build 3 shelters, let's put Jesus along with Moses and Elijah. And by the way, don't put anybody along with Jesus. If you stick a saint along with Jesus, you'll destroy Jesus. If you put the Virgin Mary along with Jesus, you will totally undermine Jesus. He stands not just 6 inches higher than these other things. He stands to the total exclusion of these other people. As the one to whom, where they are valid, they bear witness to him. And they point to him so that we might know him. And when Peter made this bizarre statement, that's when the cloud came and the voice said, this is my son whom I love. listen to him. And when the cloud lifted, there was nobody left but Jesus. And notice, it says in verse 36, that when the voice had spoken and they found that Jesus was alone, the disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at the time what they had seen. In other words, they had nothing to say. And the point I learned from that is this, that there comes a time when you do business with Jesus alone and privately. It's not a little discussion among themselves, but we do business alone with him. And you and I have to go into that secret place with Jesus. That when a man and a woman comes into a living relationship with Jesus Christ, it's not because they're caught up in the atmosphere of a meeting. That may be helpful to them in pointing them to Christ, but there is a moment when you stand alone before him. There's nothing so personal, nor nothing so deep in anybody's life than what they do with Jesus in that moment alone. Years later, and I finish with this, Peter wrote about this event. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, he said, "We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory saying, 'This is my son whom I love. With him I'm well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice that came from the heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain." This is not a cleverly invented story Peter can write several decades later. This was the revelation of the glory of Jesus Christ and the affirmation from heaven. This is not an idea. Christianity is not a good idea. It is truth about God himself becoming a human being that he might rescue us and reconcile us to himself. And I ask you as I finish, do you know him? Those of you watching on television, do you know him? You may know lots about him. You may be part of a church. But do you know him? Do you take time in this book beyond the written page, the written word, looking and finding and enjoying the living word of the Lord Jesus himself, and find he is the one to whom you can bring all your fears, all your sins, all your history, all your shame, all your brokenness, and you meet him as a friend who cleanses and restores and builds you up in himself so that you're able to live out of this place of intimacy with him, which no church can give you, no Christian friend can give you. Your spouse can't give this to you. It's important together that we share these good things of the Lord Jesus, but there has to be a time alone out of which you find your strength in him. And these disciples were left alone with no one but Jesus, because that's the point of the event. The witness of the law and the prophets and the witness of the Father in heaven will leave you alone with him. And that's where you do business. Are you doing business with Jesus Christ? Do you know him? Are you living daily out of that fellowship with him that is the source of the enrichment and strength and security that he alone can be within you? And if not, I want to recommend you get alone with him and talk to him. Tell him the truth about yourself. He knows it, but tell him it. And thank him that he will forgive you and cleanse you and be your friend and be your lover and be your life. For that's his purpose. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful this morning that we can be brought into a personal and living and fresh intimacy with yourself. It's not just that you're an item, a bullet point on our creed. I pray where we don't know you in this way, that by your Holy Spirit, who alone can draw us into that deep relationship with yourself, that he will draw us and we will come and we'll find ourselves taken up with Jesus. We pray it in his name and for his glory. Amen.
Know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message. And follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price, The Dark Night of His Soul. Do you see Jesus as a spotless figure in a long white robe? Think again. On earth, Jesus was every bit as human as you are, with the same struggles you face. He was lonely, in anguish. Like you, he was tempted. He was criticized. His life was not easy, and neither is yours. This 8-part series, The Jesus You Never Noticed, shows how the life of Jesus is a model for living your life. This series is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend,
that's King James,
or plan a group Bible study. Write to Living Truth to order by mail, or call Canada +1 416 222 3341, extension 113, or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca. Discover the real Jesus. The Jesus you never noticed.
May my life be an offering of praise. All I have, Lord, I lay it at your feet. Not just a song or the sweetest melody, I give you my life. Purify all that's hidden in my heart. A sacrifice, Lord, I desire to bring. Not just a song or the sweetest melody, give you my life. I'm living for your glory. I'm living for your faith. In view of your great mercy, I bow down at your feet.
Lord, your mercy has paved a way for me to bring a holy, pleasing offering. Not just a song or the sweetest melody, I give you my life. I'm living for your glory. I'm living for your glory, oh Lord. I'm living for your fame. In view of your great mercy, I bow down. Everything in me I surrender. Everything in me is yours, it's yours. Everything in me I surrender.
I surrender.
Everything in me is yours, it's yours.